about 2 minutes away from saying that we were top of the league? Coventry! That's the only time we'd have got to say it all season. Football can be cruel at times, folks. And hello and welcome back to another review of another Oxford United game. It's Ian here from OUFC Fan View, and I'm still picking myself up off the floor as what happened at the end of this game today. Oxford were in their second game of the season. They were away at Coventry City. Oxford were fantastic against Norwich on the opening day, and you can see my review of that in the top corner if you haven't already checked it out. But the tough games just keep on coming, folks, and Coventry is another one, and a side that absolutely battered us in the FA Cup at the start of the year. This looked a formidable test. And it certainly was, but Oxford battled and they scrapped and they almost scraped a draw. Almost. But it wasn't to be, and credit to you, Sky Blues. You kept going right till the final seconds of the game to get that winner. You eventually got it and Oxford went down. It finished Coventry City 3, Oxford United 2. Let's get this out of the way straight away. Coventry City, congratulations to you guys on that win. And overall, it was a deserved win. You were the better side for the majority of the game. You created much the better chances throughout the game as well. Just to lose it that late just felt a bit sickening from an Oxford point of view. But we will go over all of it. I'll go over the team news. I'll give my review of the game and I will give my final thoughts at the end of it. Please feel free to jump to any point of the video using the timestamps below. But if you do that, and I really need it today, please give me a like on this video because that does help me out a lot. And if you do like the content, then consider subscribing. So let's jump into this team news then, and not surprisingly, Des Buckingham named an unchanged side from that side that had that fantastic 2-0 win over Norwich on Saturday. There were a couple of changes on the bench though. Jordan Thornley and Gatlin Odonka drop out. Matt Phillips takes his place on the bench, and new loan signing Dane Scarlett is there as well. But as I said, overall, no real surprises. Let's move on to Coventry then, and the Sky Blues did lose their opening game of the season to Stoke, but they did bounce back with a 1-0 win in the Carabao Cup over Bristol City. It's a home debut for keeper Oliver Dovin. Joel Latabudier skippers the side, and he was impressive, and he scored the opening goal, I believe, in that 6-2 win that Coventry had over us in the FA Cup in January. Looking through this lineup, it's a Coventry side which oozes quality, particularly up front, and it looks like there's plenty of goals and creativity in this side through the likes of Wright, Ellis Sims, Sakamoto in there as well. It is still early on in the season, and I was kind of hoping we would still catch this Coventry side cold, a bit like what we did with Norwich. Unfortunately, that wasn't the case. And you could see that pretty much straight out of the gate. Coventry already were passing the ball around within the first 2 minutes with so much more purpose than what we saw from Norwich. And they were responding well to the loud support from the fans inside the stadium. Sakamoto already got the better of Bennett around the outside on his right, Oxford's left. And Victor Torp chanced his arm with a free kick, but it went well wide. But it was very fast-paced and very open. Goodrum got Oxford up the field on 10 minutes, tried to play in Blaheta, but Michael van Ewijk, who, spoilers, was amazing for Coventry in this game, matched his pace stride for stride and got the challenge in. And then straight away, straight up the other end, Coventry instantly responded and Radoni slipped in right. But it was a combination of Hagi Wright having a weak shot and Ciaron Brown's sliding tackle that was able to smuggle the danger away. Just a minute later though, and Cameron Branigan hit a pinpoint pass over the top, and Tyler Goodrum looked like he was through on goal, but the Coventry players got back to make it a more difficult chance for Goodrum, who just could not get the space to get his shot away, and the shot was blocked. Possibly he could have got that over to Mark Harris, but he chose to shoot, and maybe that was the wrong option. And 5 minutes later, Coventry took the lead in this game. And as I said, they did deserve it. It was 1-0 to Coventry on 15 minutes, but it started with a really slack bit of defending by Joe Bennett. It was a header just seemingly into no man's land, which allowed Sakamoto and van Ewijk to create a 2-on-1 down the Oxford left. I'm not really too sure why Bennett just didn't head that into touch, but that seems to be the way of things now that players are more would like to rather keep the ball in play, and maybe Blaheta should have been back helping out as well. But that did create the overload. It was van Ewijk who got around the side of Bennett, was able to put a wonderful cross over for Hagi Wright to just power it in for 6 or 7 yards out. It felt like a big goal, and it felt like Oxford were really up against it at this point, and Coventry really sensed that Oxford were on the ropes as they piled on the pressure and just looked sharper all over the pitch, really, in everything that they did. Wright this time got freed down the Coventry left, and Long was nowhere near him. And Hagi Wright slid across ball into the penalty area. It was just out of the reach of Ellis Sims, and Oxford again just about scrambled it away. But on 22 minutes, somehow Oxford got level in this game. It started with Tyler Goodrum winning the softest of soft free kicks on the Oxford right-hand side. And it was a bit of a piss-poor delivery by Will Vaux, actually. But somehow Oxford kept it alive. Rodriguez and Ciaron Brown won headers. Ciaron Brown's header just sort of fell into the area, and Coventry players all just stood around waiting for someone to clear it. It just hit Ellis Sims, deflected back to Ciaron Brown, and Ciaron Brown just lashed it into the bottom corner of the goal. Thank you very much. A cracking finish from Brown. Oxford's fortunate to be level, but hey-ho, we'll take it. But this didn't slow the tempo of the game down, and it didn't redress the balance of power. And just a minute later, Jack Radoni almost restored the lead. It was a rocket of a shot from 25 yards. Cumming was nowhere near it. Needed to be good to beat Jamie Cumming on this day, and that certainly was a good strike, but it just whistled wide. And 3 minutes later, Coventry did regain the lead. It was a lovely finish from Coventry's right back, Milan van Ewijk, who I think is going to be one of the key players for them this season. He was immense today. He was coming in from the Coventry right and finished it off with a lovely first-time strike into the bottom corner. But it's a ball that Oxford allowed to just bounce, really just slowly work its way across the penalty area. I felt there was three or four players that had a chance to clear that. Sakamoto actually did really well to dummy Joe Bennett out of the way to allow van Ewijk to come on and get the space. And again, Plaheta wasn't really tracking his man. But Oxford should have cleared this in the first phase. They shouldn't have allowed this ball to work its way all the way across. And it was a disappointing goal to concede from Oxford's point of view. But Coventry certainly did look threatening every time they came forward. And Cumming needed another save to deny Hagi Wright. On 39 minutes, Oxford had a rare foray forward. Long's cross found Plaheta at the back post, but he couldn't generate the power on it, and it was no trouble for Dovin. And that took us into half-time, and 2-1 to Coventry at the break. And whew, breathe, Oxford United fans. We're still in this game. Just about clinging onto Coventry's coattails. But the speed and the movement of Coventry is proving the difference in this game. And they certainly are looking a step up from the Norwich side that we faced on the opening day of the season. Sakamoto and van Ewijk are causing Bennett no end of problems down the Coventry right, Oxford left. Hagi Wright is doing the same on the other flank as well, but I feel Long's just doing a little bit better to keep him at bay. Jack Radoni is getting in acres of space and pulling the strings through the middle. A lot of attacking threat for the Sky Blues. But Oxford have had some decent moves as well. Goodrum and Plaheta have looked dangerous when Oxford have been able to free them early and get them on the break. Both of them do look a threat on the break as well. Plaheta's he's working hard, he's doing okay, but he's a little bit suspect at the back. And also as well, we're seeing the Will Vaux long throw for the first time, which is good to see. But as I said, you can't get away from it. It's 2-1 to Coventry. They deserve to be in the lead. Can Oxford hang in there and get something from this game? We'll find out in the second half. The signs didn't look good right from the offing in this second half, because Coventry just picked up from where they left off, and after 20 seconds of the second half already, Torp had an effort on goal which was deflected over, and a minute later Radoni in acres of space plays Sims into the area. Sims goes for power with his shot, but he can only power it into the stands. But maybe I was being a little bit harsh on Oxford, because on 55 minutes we did tie this game up. It was probably our best move. Well, I'm not even going to say probably. It was our best move of the game, but it ended with the scruffiest of scruffiest finishes. Tyler Goodrum started the move with a wonderful drop of the shoulder, which sold two Coventry players up the river. He then played Brannigan down the right-hand side. Branner's picked out Rodriguez with a pinpoint cross, and it was a diving header from Rodriguez. Strange choice, but he can be good with his diving headers. We've seen it in the past, but this time he only managed to head it across goal, and it just hit Mark Harris and bundled its way into the back of the net. Harris looked very sheepish when the ball went in. He thought he was offside, but Victor Torp getting back to track. Brannigan was playing Harris onside, and the goal stood. and Oxford once again were level. Oxford made a double change after that goal when Matt Phillips and Idris El-Masouni came on for Plaheta and Rodriguez. Not really a surprise for those two substitutions. And Mark Harris, after scoring that goal, needed to be good in defending in the Oxford box as a heck of a volley from Victor Torp was turned behind by Sparky. 65 minutes on the clock and Coventry was certainly still probing, and Oxford seemed like they were struggling more and more to get possession and get up the pitch, and two more chances for the Sky Blues. Hagi Wright headed over from a Van Ewijk cross, but before that, Cumming produced a fantastic save on the line to keep out a point blank Louis Binks header. Binks should have scored this. It was from a corner and he was really close to the goal, but somehow Cumming got across to keep it out. But after that point, the game did drift a little bit and Oxford did start to look a little bit more assured on the ball. Coventry still with the lion's share of possession, but Oxford still started to pick their way out of the Coventry press a little bit better as the game went on. But we couldn't really create any cutting edge chances. And as we moved into the final 10-15 minutes, Oxford was still battling. The game did lull a little bit, but maybe Coventry were just gearing up for that final flourish. But the game did go scrappy for the first time in the night, which from an Oxford point of view wasn't a bad thing. And Oxford created a decent chance on 81 minutes. Louis Sibley, who came on for Goodrum, looked lively when he came on as well. He got in space down the right-hand side. His cross was a good one, but it was just out of the reach of Harris, and Dovin couldn't gather the ball as he stretched to keep it out, and the rebound just got ahead of Phillips. But it seemed like every time Oxford had a chance, Coventry created one just seconds later, and that chance seemed to spur Coventry into life as Wright got space in the penalty area, picked out Palmer with his cross, but Palmer's shot was wild and over the bar. And with every one of these misses, you sensed it was going to be a point that Oxford might have been able to squirrel away. 88 minutes. And it became the Jamie Cumming show on 88 minutes. It's wow, wow, wow. I say it three times because they were three cracking saves from Jamie Cumming, who was keeping Oxford in this game. First, a deflected cross reached Wright in the middle. Wright tried to place the shot. Cumming got down to save it. Pretty routine save from Cumming there. But what was excellent from Cumming was how quickly he got up to do phenomenally well to deny Mason Clark from close range. And 1 minute later, the ball was recycled by Coventry. It came out to Louis Binks. He was a long way out, but it was a super strike from Binks with power. And Cumming got down once again to turn it behind. 7 minutes added on and Coventry were piling on the pressure with crosses, but Oxford were standing firm. We were even getting up the pitch at times, and it seemed like we were going to get this point. It seemed like we were going to go top of the league. Unthinkable. But on 95 minutes, disaster struck. Absolute disaster. Will Vaux, who again had another super game for Oxford United with a very uncharacteristic... Well, I say it's uncharacteristic, but he did this in the Norwich game and got away with it. So that's two in two for Vaux. You need to cut it out, Will. Plays a back pass, which ended up being a fantastic through ball for Hagi Wright, who ran through on goal, rounded Jamie Cumming and calmly slotted into the back of the net to break Oxford's heart, to send Coventry into jubilation and to win this game for Coventry City. There was another late chance as well on the break for Coventry to make it 4-2. I think Cumming produced another save or Coventry spurned it. But in the end, Coventry get the win. A cruel way for Oxford to lose. But overall, I'll say it again, Coventry did deserve to win this game. It was just heartbreaking that they did it in the final few seconds. And that brings me on to my final thoughts, and let's start with the home sides in Coventry City. And my goodness, I was so impressed with the way you played today. You didn't get the six goals like you got when we played in the FA Cup, but you created enough chances to score more than the three, I would say that. And you carved Oxford open time and time again. There was so much last-ditch defending or good goalkeeping that kept the ball out of that net. The attacking prowess of Hagi Wright, Sakamoto, looks daunting for any side. You've got so much quality down those wings. Van Ewijk and Sakamoto, I don't know how many sides are going to live with those two going forward. Coventry fans, you've got to be extremely excited about those two guys. I thought Jack Radone looked fantastic. He faded a little bit as the game went on, but he was picking up so many pockets of space in the first half and the start of the second half as well. Oxford really couldn't live with him. Victor Thorpe, I think there's more to come with him, but I thought he had a courage in display as well. And all in all, this is a Coventry side. I would look at it and think they're going to be right up the league challenging. You should be expecting to be up there challenging, at least in the playoffs this season with the side you've got. Imagine how good that midfield's going to be when you get Ben Sheath back. But all in all, very impressed with Coventry City. Good luck for the rest of the season, you guys. I'm absolutely gutted we weren't able to hang on for that draw, but as I said, once again, it would have flattered Oxford to get that point, and you created more than enough chances to win this game. So as I say, good luck for the rest of the season. Leave your comments down below on what you think is going to happen this season, and just your genuine thoughts on the game. That brings me on to the U's and another fighting, scrapping, battling performance that we've come to expect from Des Buckingham's Oxford United. On this occasion, we ended up on the wrong side of it, but you've got to be proud of the effort, and you've got to be proud of the fight back, and you've got to be proud of the way we just kept going and kept fighting. It was very unfortunate to lose the game in the way we did, but there was still so much encouragement to take away from that game. The defending was at times last ditch, and you definitely felt the Oxford players struggled with the step up in class that Coventry presented in terms of the way they pressed Oxford. The way they moved the ball was so much better than what we saw against Norwich. And Oxford were, there's certainly times in this game where we were pinned in, and all we could do was just put our backs to the wall and try and keep the ball out of the net. That we are going to have to ride our luck in these games and just try and hang on and get anything we can from these games. And we needed everybody to be exceptional, and they kind of were, but it still didn't end up with the points, which is disappointing. It would have been lovely to say we've gone top of the league, but other than the fact that if we'd have lost that game with a goal from Coventry in like the 75th minute, I think it would have been an easier game to take. Of course it would have been. It's just that last minute goal was really, you know, really, really soured the night, really. Jamie Cumming was immense in goal, made some fantastic saves. Everything that we've known that Cumming can bring to Oxford. He's produced wonderful saves in so many games, and this was another one. He was unfortunate to be on the losing side. Bennett and Long struggled, but are they going to face the quality? Well, they might do, but Coventry have got exceptional wide players, and I'm not surprised that they did. I would actually say I think it was a good tactical decision by Buckingham to switch Plaheta and Goodrum, or even Phillips came on the other side, and have Goodrum on that side, who certainly played with a little bit more defensive nous than Plaheta saw. Because really, if you're going to be really harsh on Plaheta, his work rate was good, but his defensive work was naive in the first half, and he really sold Joe Bennett up the river, really, and left him exposed. And although Joe Bennett could have done better with the first goal by just heading the ball out of play, and it's an area where Oxford are going to have to look at, and I would actually be surprised if we do see Plaheta starting many games once you get Ebue and Phillips back up to speed. But I thought Goodrum was impressive again in this Oxford team. I don't know how you can leave him out of the side. I would say that Brannigan and Volks did struggle. I thought Volks is such a good player. It's so weird that he's had these couple of brain fades. As I say, he got away with one against Norwich. He didn't get away with this one today. But he just looks such a quality player in that midfield. I thought Brannigan will be better for that workout today of like knowing what he needs to do, the speed and the pace he needs to play at in possession and out of possession as well. You do get the feeling as well that Widrissel Mosuni is going to be pushing this midfield close as well. He looked pretty classy when he came on once again. I thought Phillips looked lively when he came on. Just a calm, assured touch in the middle as Oxford did start to get a little bit more control in the end of that second half. Harris worked his socks off once again. He's living off scraps at the top of the field. It was so nice that he is getting the run of the ball and the break of the ball. And Oxford certainly did get the bounce of the ball going their way today until that final sort of seconds of the game. And it was nice to see Harris bundle a ball in and make it 2-2 for him. So an encouraging start for Harris. We didn't see much of Dane Scarlett. Little bit disappointed with Rodriguez, actually. I thought he really struggled today. I thought him and Plaheta, not surprising they were the first two players to come off because I thought Rodriguez was quite quiet. If you watched the game back, you'd say he's involved in both of the goals. But overall, his play wasn't fantastic. And he's a player you look at and think, is it going to be Goodrum who plays in that 10 role Are you going to bring Ivrissel Massouni in or even Louis Sibley into that middle as well? But yeah, Rodriguez just needs to up his game a little bit, because I thought he was the one who really struggled. But not a disastrous performance by any stretch of the imagination. And all in all, not too much to really be that worried about or disappointed about. We knew this was going to be a step up in class. We knew this was going to be a difficult league. And Coventry have just shown us everything that we've known, really. Are we closer to Coventry than we were when we lost 6-2? I would say we are. Are we that much closer? Probably not. I would say that that's what it's going to be when we're competing against the sides at the top of this league. We caught Norwich cold. We didn't catch Coventry cold. And it'll be unlikely that we catch any other side cold. And those sides that are gunning for the Premiership are going to be having players that just move the ball with more speed and more movement than probably we can handle. And we're just going to have to see if we can get away with it a bit in those games. But we certainly battled and we certainly competed tonight. And that is what you'd expect. That's the least you expect. But it was nice that Oxford do it. Oxford could have easily caved in this game when Coventry were piling on the pressure. But we kept going. We kept going. We nearly got that point. It just wasn't to be. It feels like a big game now against Blackburn in a week's time. I'm not actually going to be watching that game. Because I've got family visiting and stuff, so I won't be doing a review of that one. But I will be doing a preview video with Rovers Overseas, who's a guy who does the same sort of thing, but for Blackburn Rovers. That'll be on his channel coming out in the week, sort of Tuesday and Thursday. So check out Rovers Overseas for that one. And yeah, it'll be an interesting game, because I don't think Blackburn are going to play with are a side that play in the same vein as what we've seen at Coventry. So I think you might see a Blackburn side that do sit off Oxford a little bit and let Oxford have the ball. And it'll be interesting to see how we attack that game at home. But would have been lovely to have 4 points. It wasn't to be. We nearly squirreled something away from Coventry tonight. But to have 3 points from two games is still a good return at this stage. And I'll be back to do a review. The next one will be the Preston game, I believe, in a couple of weeks' time. So thank you very much for watching. Might actually be the Coventry game, actually, in the League Cup. Yay, we get to play Coventry again. Thanks very much for watching, guys. Leave your comments down below. I'm sure there's stuff I've missed that you've picked out in this one. But don't be too sad. It was still a decent performance. It just wasn't to be. And as I go and cry away my Friday night, thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.